Welcome to the cardiovascular system, pathological features. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the histology wizard. In this tutorial, we'll talk about several pathological changes that occur within heart muscle and in the vasculature. We'll start with myocardial changes, specifically cardiac hypertrophy. Recall that hypertrophy can be a normal response to increased stress on the heart, whether that's from increased pressure or increased volume. The heart responds by thickening its walls or enlarging the chamber. If we look at micrographs of hypertrophied hearts, we see that the image on the right has larger and thicker fibers, and these fibers are much more disorganized, and they have larger nuclei. And remember that these heart muscle fibers aren't increasing in number, but they are getting bigger. Mechanistically, how does this happen, and when does this happen? We're going to take a fairly simplistic view of hypertrophy, bearing in mind that our understanding of this process is constantly undergoing revision as we learn more. In the simplified cartoon, the heart gets bigger during normal development by both hyperplasia and hypertrophy of muscle fibers, in order to reach the size of the heart that's necessary for adult function. And there are times when the heart temporarily needs to accommodate more volume or work harder, and this normal response is called physiological hypertrophy. Two examples of this are during pregnancy and strenuous exercise. But there are two basic mechanisms for the increase in size. Eccentric hypertrophy, where sarcomeres are added in two directions so that they increase in length and width, allowing for a bigger chamber to accommodate more volume. And concentric hypertrophy, where sarcomeres are added in width, making a thicker wall. Physiological hypertrophy preserves cardiac function, and it's often reversible when the stimulus is discontinued. In contrast, pathological hypertrophy occurs when the stimulus continues. Although the process is much more complicated than shown here, in general, hypertension or valve stenosis can lead to concentric hypertrophy. In this case, those sarcomeres are added in parallel and in larger numbers, leading to a thicker wall and eventually a smaller chamber. Myocardial infarction or other cardiomyopathies can lead to eccentric hypertrophy, with sarcomeres added in series, greatly dilating the chamber without increasing wall thickness. Now, in both of these cases, cardiac function may temporarily increase, but eventually decreases, and ultimately fibrosis occurs, impeding contractility. This hypertrophy is generally not reversible. Hypertrophy is a great example of how cellular modifications can occur that help an organ adapt to changes, but under continual assault or stress, similar processes can lead to dysfunction and disease. Another series of changes occurs as a result of myocardial infarction. A blockage in an artery that feeds the heart tissue can lead to death of muscle tissue. In this example, a block in a coronary artery causes local ischemia, which leads to the death of cardiac muscle and vasculature near the left apex. But why can't the muscle regenerate? Well, the main problem is that stem cells in cardiac muscles divide slowly, so the replacement of lost tissue is ineffective. Here's an example of a heart after an MI. You can see the infarcted region marked by the star. Why, this image shows a rupture in the myocardium, where a second infarction occurred days after the initial infarction, causing the severe tear through the weakened wall. Well, what does the histology of cardiac muscle look like after an infarction? The cardiac muscle undergoes very characteristic changes as the heart attempts to repair itself, and pathologists can look at the heart muscle tissue and determine when an MI occurred based upon these microscopic findings. Here we'll show some examples of recent myocardial infarctions. First, about 3 to 4 days after an MI, the muscle fibers are necrotic and there are large numbers of immune cells, mostly neutrophils. But later, macrophages invade. This is around 1 to 2 weeks. And together, these cells are going to initiate the process of repair. But again, since the muscle fibers are not replaced, the infarcted fibers become necrotic. And you can see here that some of these fibers lack nuclei. Weeks to months later, those necrotic fibers are replaced by dense irregular connective tissue through fibrosis. And as a consequence, this area of the heart cannot contract, and thus heart function is compromised. As with most tissues and organs, age can affect the vasculature. We won't go into great detail in this course, but there are changes in vascular structure that are normal with aging, but can also be pathological. These include loss of elasticity and a decrease in the volume of smooth muscle. Hypertension can cause degenerative changes in the walls of small vessels, which can stimulate endothelial cells. As we discussed in a previous tutorial, those endothelial cells, when they're stimulated, may cause more changes, particularly in the tunica intima. All of these changes can lead to hardening of the arterial walls, which compromises the ability of the vessel to constrict and dilate, and this in turn impedes blood flow. In addition, there can be the formation of blood clots, which may obstruct the lumen of vessels, further reducing blood flow and oxygen supply, similar to what we saw when we discussed myocardial infarctions. The organs will get less blood, reducing their function until something will eventually fail. One example of vascular pathologies is atherosclerotic plaques. Arteries can narrow due to atherosclerosis, a specific process that involves deposition of fat and lipids and formation of plaques that narrow the pipe and block blood flow. This is often linked to diabetes or familial hypercholesterolemia, and calcification or fibrosis can also be part of this process. Shown here are several examples of severe narrowing in coronary arteries. The left image also shows an added complication, a large bluish area of calcification. Another complication that occurs more often in elastic arteries is an aneurysm. So this is a dilation of that blood vessel that often involves the entire vessel wall. Here you can see a large aneurysm just above the aortic bifurcation. As a result, there's a weakening in the aortic wall which can lead to angina, ischemia, myocardial infarction, or rupture. Aortic aneurysms generate heart murmurs caused by increased blood turbulence in the area that's dilated or ballooned. And complications of aneurysms are most often related to rupture, as seen here. Another disease that predominantly affects elastic arteries is Marfan syndrome. This disease, caused by mutations in the fibrillin 1 gene, leads to abnormal elastic fibers. Here you can see a comparison of the tunica media in a normal aorta and in a Marfan syndrome patient's aorta. This large disruption of the largest tunic weakens the vessel, and thus Marfan's patients are at high risk of aortic dissecting aneurysms. Here's an example of an aortic dissection where the tear is above the aortic valve. So what does this look like under the microscope? Shown here are several examples of aortic dissection, both showing the tear extending through the tunica media. The blood in these cases can either dissect down to the coronary arteries and shut them off, or dissect up to close off the carotids. In either case, this is an extreme emergency and can quickly lead to death. There are many other pathologies that affect the heart and blood vessels, but we'll stop here for today. Thanks for stopping by.